We're here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
You can send your questions to us by emailing questions@tabletopbellhop.com or clicking on Ask the Bellhop over on our blog.
While two-player games are the thing we get asked about the most often, a close second is games to play with kids that are fun for adults. This ranges from teachers looking for games for their classrooms, grandparents looking to entertain their grandchildren, gamer parents looking for games to enjoy with their own kids, and people hosting public play events looking to have a small selection of kids' games on hand just in case.
Now, to go with this, pretty much by chance, we've been playing more games aimed at kids lately. This is a mix of stuff we've gotten from publishers at cons, as well as stuff we've been sent in the mail. And what stuck out about this wave of modern family games we've been playing is just how solid, strategic, and tactical they are.
Now, we mashed these ideas together to come up with a list of great family games that are just as good for adults as they are for kids.
And now, this isn't to be confused with a previous topic we had that was about games that look like they're for kids but aren't. That was back on episode 207. Now, that talk featured games that were marketed at kids, or at least looked like kid games, or had a very children's, silly, cute theme that actually weren't good for playing with kids, or were absolutely terrible for playing with kids, and were actually very adult games that just happened to look like they might have been for kids. Tonight's the opposite end. We're talking about the other end. Now, these are games, literally the publisher is like, these are for kids and families, and that are great for kids, but also end up being awesome for adults, whether by design or chance.
Going even further back to episode 123, Playing Together, we talked about the best cooperative games for families. And while tonight's list may have some overlap, we're not just looking at cooperative games. And that episode is almost 3 years old at this point.
Yeah, and I actually went in and double-checked the old blog posts, and there's actually one overlap, which kind of blew me away. Some of that, though, is because you can't find some of the games that were on that old list. So feel free to go check those out. Now, one of the things we are going to do tonight is make sure that we're only sharing games that are currently in print and easy to get at your friendly local game store or your favorite online game store. That is something I can't promise when you go back to those old lists. And I can tell you for a fact, at least the one from episode 123, you won't be able to find every game on that list now.
Well, tonight's list is going to feature games that are quick to get to the table, play relatively quickly, and have easy-to-remember rules, and in general, feature themes that will appeal to a younger audience. You want engaging and not overwhelming games that challenge while being compatible with potentially shorter attention span of younger players.
So, as usual, this list is in no particular order, sort of, except for this first one, because I specifically wanted to start with a very specific game that's over my shoulder behind me here, and that is Rec Raiders from Kids Table Board Gaming. This is, we're going to do a full review later on the show, and honestly, this game and the company that makes it is a big inspiration for this actual topic in the first place. It's been playing Rec Raiders and other games we've gotten recently, but that one really stuck out as this would be a cool topic to talk about that we haven't covered in the past. Now, Rec Raiders itself is a quick-to-learn dice-drafting worker placement game all about sending divers down to shipwrecks to find treasures and shells. You're going to use the treasures to fill museum orders, as well as keeping some highlights for your own personal vault. The shells can be traded in to help mitigate some of the randomness in the game, as well as used to purchase aquarium tanks for endgame scoring.
This is a fun game that's really got some solid strategy and thinking required, but not so much that it will leave the game unplayed by the youngins, and enough randomness with a fun drop table to entertain the kids, while still having a multi-part strategy for adults to explore.
Now, what I want to note here is that this is the first game ever we have played and reviewed from Kids Table Board Gaming. And I put them first on the list because this game really stood out as being perfect for what we're talking about tonight. This is a perfect family weight game that even experienced gamers will enjoy. And the thing is, that's what KTBG is. That's what they're trying to do. That's what their mission statement is. It's what they want to do with all their games. And no, this episode is not sponsored by Kids Table Board Gaming or anything like that. It's just happened that we discovered their game. And based on what we saw, Rec Raiders and other games we got to see at Origins, games like Creature Comforts and Fossilis, I think that's how it's pronounced, like Fossils with IS, Fossilis, I think. And I got to say, this has to be called out as a publisher that's currently, as far as I can tell, doing the best job of creating the types of games we're talking about tonight. The fast food or food frenzy, that one looks really neat, where you actually get a cleaver and cut up your dice. Oh, their games just look so great. And honestly, I got to say, we've only tried one, but check out Kids Table Board Games, Board Gaming.
Not surprisingly, a company called Kids Table would lean this way, but reading their mission statement really stands out. The games that they bought for their kids were too childish for the adults or too hard for the kids, rarely managed to challenge both sides of the table. So they set out to solve this by developing games well-suited for the whole family.
And from our chat room, we've already got a recommendation for Haunt the House from Kids at KTBG. So yeah, number one, Recreators.
Next up, we have a game we just reviewed last week, Mlem Space Agency from Rebel Studio. A sci-fi themed push-your-luck dice game from Rinyarnitsia about cats in space with some great in-the-box expansions to help find the right balance of thinkiness.
Yeah, Mlem continues to be a big hit here. My kids dig it. I'll be testing it out in public, hopefully, at a local gaming event coming up this Saturday. I plan on bringing this one out. I think it's going to be a hit for the casual game crowd. And I'd be shocked if people aren't looking to play it just based on the cover and the name of the game and the fact it's cats in space. Next, I have King Me from Ravensburger, which is kind of the opposite of Mlem. Because when I put Mlem out on the table, people are going to be like, "Ooh, cat game, what's that?" Well, when I put this on a table, everyone's going to be like, "I don't know, they're just going to pass aside and look at other stuff." No one's going to want to play it because it looks like it's just a box of checkers. It looks like I am just putting down a themed set of checkers with fantasy art on the cover. And in a way, people are right, because King Me really is just an updated version of checkers. But it's checkers converted to an area majority game, where different areas of the board are going to score each round, and that's randomly generated by cards. The basic mechanics and the jumping is the same as checkers, but after that, this is actually almost a bit of a Euro game. This is an area majority, and the basic mechanics are simple enough to learn for kids, but it really shines when you get a couple experienced checker players facing off against each other.
Notably, this is from Prospero Hall before they moved to and were taken in by Funko, which for me, and I think Mo as well, is really their strongest period and where we came to love their work.
Yeah.
It's King Me, checkers, but so much more. Now, next up, we have a game that we're very happy that we could put on this list tonight, and that is Go Cuckoo, which has been a huge hit at local public play events and has been enjoyed by local gamers from ages 6 to over 70. Yeah. This is a fantastic dexterity game originally by Habba that has now come back in print thanks to Devere Games. It's kind of like reverse pickup sticks, where you take turns pulling sticks from a tin and then placing them on top of the tin, building a nest to hold your eggs. The first player to play all of their eggs and then the chunky cuckoo meeple wins. Now, if you haven't seen this at your local FLGS yet, be sure to ask for it, as it should be in stock everywhere by now.
Yeah, everywhere I looked online had copies. This is a really good game, and I'm so glad people can get it again. I'm already calling it out in the chat, but I knew Tech would be here. Go Cuckoo is back in print, but it's from Devere Games now. So if you're calling up, you know, one of our local game stores, you got to have them look under Devere. D-E-V-I-R is the new publisher of the fantastic dexterity game Go Cuckoo. Huge hit with everyone I played it with. Now, one of the first kids games that a hobby gamer put in front of me with no kids around that kind of got me a side eye where I was like, well, what are you doing? Was another hobby game. And this was Animal Upon Animal. And I didn't question that being put in front of me after the second or third turn. This is a classic stacking dexterity game. It's one of Habba's evergreen games that will always be in print and now exists in a wide variety of different editions, themes, and varieties. Gameplay in all of them is basically the same. Roll a die and place the matching animal, meeple, whatever shape onto the growing pile and try not to knock things over. Now, my kids loved this one, and we'd still play it regularly if they hadn't lost the majority of the pieces as they were growing up.
Well, this one certainly isn't a thinky one, and fans of Dex game and people who aren't fans of Dex games will run. But this game has layers, and not just layers of animals. Now, I still really have a hard time keeping a straight face while talking about this game, but it is what it is, and that's animal upon animal. Now, sticking with dexterity games, next up is Drop It from Cosmos, a game they say is great for 8+, but the community lists as great for kids as young as 5. You drop colored shapes into a plastic holder, Tetris style, but make sure not to touch the same color or shape as the piece you just dropped. This physics game is a ton of fun with gamers of any age.
Yeah, I love Drop It. Also fantastic for public play events. Actually, the more I think about it, the more this entire list is probably great as a great list of games for an all ages public play event, like we like to host here in Windsor. So we're going to have some overlap there, as the good family weight games are also good casual games to woo in new and old gamers. Now, speaking of local events, at our last barbershop bar game night, which there were no kids there, there was a 7-player group playing through Camel Up from Eggert Spiel. This is a somewhat over-the-top, silly camel race slash betting game where the camels can land on top of each other. And then when one camel moves, it brings all the ones on top with it, which leads to some really unpredictable races and a lot of hilarity. Now, the new second printing of this even has what they call the crazy camel, which is one going the wrong direction. This one's always a hoot, always gets a lot of laughs, just as fun for kids as it is for adults.
Now, this is one I've only ever played once at a New Year's Eve party years ago. And while fun, I must say it didn't at the time leave a lasting impression.
Fair.
But since you mentioned a game that mashes up racing and betting, I feel the need to bring up Downforce. Now, this is a game that did leave an impression, and a good one. This is a modern reprint of the classic 1990s kids racing game Top Race. This comes from Restoration Games, who are known for taking people's favorite childhood games and updating them to appeal to more serious gamers. Now, the end result is similar to kids' table board gaming, creating family, great family weight games that experienced gamers will enjoy just as much as the kids. And Downforce is a fantastic example of this.
Yeah, we found a copy of this one cheap and honestly didn't expect much from it, but it ended up being a great game. And one that's been a big hit, both with my kids and other local gamers. Next is a game I didn't even think of as a kid's game, but it makes total sense when I saw it come up on the Board Game Geek list of children's games. Because as I've admitted before, we do some research before we do these topics. And I always look to see what other people think. And that game is Taco Cat Goat Cheese Pizza. This is a silly card game that's been around for quite some time, but I only personally discovered it last year. Now, it's a hand-shedding game. You are trying to play your entire hand of cards by going taco, play a card, cat, play a card, taco, cat, goat, cheese, pizza. Everyone's throwing down cards as they say the words. As soon as the card matches what you're saying, so you throw down pizza when you said pizza, everyone tries to slap the pile. The last person to slap the pile takes all the cards. First player to lose all their cards wins. That's pretty much it. Now, to make things interesting, there's some other special cards like groundhogs and narwhals with their own special actions. You don't need to know that to get the gist. This was a surprise hit for me. I did not think I would enjoy this too much. I for some reason, it set better with me than Happy Salmon. Happy Salmon required you running around tables. At least this one, you can sit in one place and play. And I've been shocked by the number of local gamers I've introduced this game to who have now went and picked up copies. And it is the kind of game that everyone is going to laugh. Just don't play with anyone with nails that are too sharp.
Though being Canadian, we should probably be recommending Taco Puck Maple Syrup Canoe.
Fair.
Now, speaking of games we don't think of as kids' games, despite playing with kids, next we have Pitch Car, which says ages 6+ on the box. You don't get much more kids' game than that. Now, this is, of course, the wonderful flicking race game from Eagle Griffin Games that we like to set up for any big board game events. Now, while the base game is fun with its straights and curves, various expansions and fan-made pieces can lead to some truly wondrous tracks.
Yeah, we love Pitch Car around here, and I've got to say, now that 3D printers are a lot more common, the maker community for Pitch Car has some really fantastic stuff out there. Next, I'm going to call out one that is obviously a kid's game, marketed as a kid's game. It's from Haba, the kid's game company, and that is Rhino Hero. Now, as we have had this game for a long time, and it has been in our family for a long time, and as the kids get older, and we played a number of times, we have found we're too good at the game. So this comes with a caveat of you may need more than one copy of the game because we've gotten too good at it and we run out of cards. Now, this is a cute game where you are building a skyscraper out of folded cards, where players play roofs and the next player has to put folded cards onto the roof. And it has some fun take that elements like forcing your opponent to move the little wooden rhino meeple up the growing wobbly tower. Now, there is a newer version of this called Rhino Hero Super Battle that I hear is more of a family weight game and is just as good, if not better. Now, our friends Kat and Tori strongly recommend this one, but I've yet to get Tori to bring it over to actually play it, so I haven't tried it myself.
Rhino Hero is quite the silly game, but personally, in large part due to my coffee intake, I am utterly useless at it. I can't even get a second layer. So while I do enjoy Dex games, this one in particular has eluded me completely. Now, another really silly game, something very toyetic, which you're probably going to have a hard time getting people to play at first, is, at least until you've got them got it set up, is Lupin Louie. Now, this game shouldn't be as fun as it is. And while it's not going to keep an experienced gamer occupied all night, we've yet to find anyone who didn't have fun playing a round or two. And as for the kids, we've seen groups play it for hours and hours on end.
Yes. We had it at an Extra Life event, and I think it got played for about 6 hours straight. Now, it was mostly some of the gamers' kids, but there were gamers in there every round, at least one, playing around with this game. Now, I have to give credit to a childhood friend of both of ours, John Solalula, for introducing me to this game. I would have never thought a group of adults would have that much fun what is basically a preschooler toy. Okay, maybe the heavy gamers won't like it, but you know what? I'm pretty sure if I sit Charles down there with his little flicker, he's not going to stop playing until someone wins. Like, it is so much fun. Now, next is another game from Rebel Studio. Now, this is the same company that brought us the first game on the list. Second game on the list, Mlem. That is Chronicles of Avel. This is a cooperative tower defense game with a very fun bag pulling magic item inventory system. Like, if you get a magic reward, you reach in this bag and everything's unique shape. So you can kind of feel around, try to feel a sword and pull it out. And I don't remember it now because it's been a while since we played, but there's a rhyme you're supposed to say. My girls were obsessed with this rhyme. You were not allowed to pull your hand out of that bag without saying the rhyme before you got your magic item. We really enjoyed this one from start to finish. Kids love the evocative artwork, non-standard fantasy creatures. We're going to call it out tonight. There was even a die drop table for naming your characters included. Like, there's a lot of cool things going in here. You get your character sheet. You get to draw on it. It's really neat game. I noticed when I was doing research for this, it's currently ranked number 6 on Board Game Geek for children's games. So we're not the only ones who have been enjoying Chronicles of Avel. Now, I do have the first big box expansion right behind me on a stack, kind of off camera here. It is called New Adventures for Chronicles of Avel. And the whole family is looking forward to diving back into the Avel universe.
Yeah, this one as a game really hit a lot of those hallmarks that KTBG was looking for in games. And I think puts Rebel Studios very much on the same sort of footing with a lot of their recent games. Yeah. They do have some distinctly non-family games in their catalog as well. But that was Chronicles of Avel. Now, the last game I have for you tonight is Tapple from our friends at The Op. This is a game that Moe's girls play on a regular basis at school. It's been a game that's been in just about every classroom since, you know, grade 4 or so, and one that the girls still enjoy. It's a game that gets together the whole family, from the youngest to the oldest, around the table. That's Tapple, a fantastic word game. It can be fun to play by the rules in the box, but can also just be really fun to house rule, making up your own categories.
Yeah, I'm so happy to finally own Tapple. It's a really solid game. This is the one game. It's our new Gorinto in a way, because Gorinto's already a hobby game, but this is the one I'm like, no, hobby gamers. Like, if you host public play events, you do New Year's nights, if you ever have family over, grab a copy of Tapple. You just need a filler while you're waiting for the pizza to show up. It is a fantastic one. All right, my final game and the last one for tonight's list. No, we will have some honorable mentions as usual, is Castle Panic. Now, specifically the big box version, which we reviewed last year. Well, the original Castle Panic is a decent family weight tower defense game and nothing against it. But I know many gamers and gamer parents who do dig it, but it's just a little light. It's a little light for my taste. I'll play it now and then. But when you get the big box with all the expansions, you can tweak that so that it's that perfect level where the kids are still having fun and drawing monsters and laughing about what's happening. And the parents are helping them make the detailed plans and managing their resources and so on. Now, the one caveat, of course, is that the Castle Panic Deluxe is not a cheap game. So if money is an issue, I would consider picking up the base game and the Crowns and Quests expansion to start. Then, if you're enjoying it with your family, add in the Wizard's Tower. And then if you still want more, you can add the other expansions.
Now, this is another game where the dials you get in the box to help manage the time and difficulty are really what, you know, solidify it in this category. Yeah. You can age up the game and tweak it to suit your family's needs so flexibly with those expansions. Well, now next we have a rather sad list of honorable mentions. First up, Ghost Fight and Treasure Hunters, especially with the Creepy Cellar expansion, which we had planned to feature on the main list.
Yep.
But sadly, it looks like finally it is out of print. After coming out in 2013 with the expansion coming out 5 years later, keeping the game going, but it seems that that has finally died off. This is a fantastic cooperative game, very approachable for kids, but a ton of fun with a group of adults. We're just hoping it comes back into print at some point.
Next, Survive Escape from Atlantis. Well, I was surprised. Ghost Fighting Treasure Hunters wasn't around anymore. It's a Hasbro game. It may come back at some point. I was shocked to know that Survive Escape from Atlantis is out of print. It's a classic game. It's been around since 1982. It's been kept in print for years by Stronghold Games. Before Terraforming Mars, this was Stronghold's evergreen game. This was their moneymaker. But as of today, at least, it looks like the game isn't as evergreen as I thought. It's not readily available anywhere right now. Now, this is a game about trying to escape from a sinking island with your little meeples trying to escape on boats and sharks that can attack them. And this is a super cutthroat game, but the kind of cutthroat that's just like silly and fun. And it's one that every time I played it with kids, the kids take a obscene level of joy in, you know, eating their parents' meeples and their siblings' meeples and crashing their ships. And it's that very cutthroat, take that, but with a silly theme that makes it not quite as nasty.
Well, another game we had on the list until verifying its availability or sadly unavailability is Ice Cool. We're sorry to see that it does seem to be maybe not dead at this point, but it was a cool flicking dexterity game that featured little plastic penguins that you flicked around a school made out of boxes flipped upside down. It was a great game for gamers of all ages. And it seems like you may be still able to get it across Europe, but to the best of our knowledge, no one in North America is distributing it or Ice Cool 2 or Ice Cool Wizards.
Now, there was supposed to be a follow-up to that, and I did not do the due diligence to look it up. That was mecha-based, and it was two-layered. I remember talking to them about reviewing it once it was finally published. I wonder what happened to that. I'm going to have to look into that. And then just a question from the chat that I'm going to address right now. The Space Attack version is also, like, I don't know if they finally let the Survive license lapse. Like, to be fair, Stronghold Games no longer exists, right? They merged and are now Indie Game Studios. Sorry, I probably should have looked that one up. But they are no longer a standalone company. A couple companies merged together, and that might have changed the licensing. But no, Space Attack, which actually is, that's the version I have, is behind me, is also out of print. Now, finally, I want to call out one other one. You can see it right above Tapple on my shelf there. And it is a series of games that were published by ELO. Now, ELO North America was shut down, and I think that's why we can't find these anymore. And that is the Tales and Games series. These are a series of games that were made to look like books on a bookshelf based on classic fairy tales and, you know, the Grimm's fairy tales and things like that. I was super bummed to find out the series is deluxe because these were really solid games. This is one of an early indicator, like the first Origins we went to, we got to see these games of that attempt by a published, established board game company trying to make kids games that are fun for the whole family that even hobby gamers will enjoy. And I'm so sad to see this series gone. Now, I'm going to call out at least one game here. I'm going to call it the one that we still kept in our collection, even after multiple purges with the kids, and that is The Hare and the Tortoise. That one is a ton of fun card-playing racing game where, of course, you know, the turtle doesn't move as fast as the hare. Sorry, I'm drawing a blank. Doesn't move as fast as the hare, but then the hare gets tired and so on. Kids kept playing this one long after the recommended age, and I'm very sad to see. Now, I did look it up. It doesn't even look like these are available in the EU either. So I'm not sure if ELO just canceled the series or what happened there.
Well, there you have 18 game recommendations from us in regards to kids' games that are just as fun for adults as they are for the kids. Well, now that you've heard our list, it's time for us to see what the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch, has been adding. And the first ones I see are both Robot Turtles and Outfoxed.
Both of those were on the old list when I said that we have a list of cooperative kids games that are just as engaging for adults. That was the original. And my opinion has changed on that. So when we first published that, I totally agree. But I have played Outfoxed is fun the first two or three times as an adult. After that, though, it's just not that engaging. Now, it's a neat deduction game with a little bit of roll and move in there where you're trying to figure out which of the people in a town have stolen a pie. And you're a fox trying to figure this out. And it has this really cool toy of where you put the clue cards in and it tells you things like, yes, he had a hat, or no, he didn't. It's well done. The kids enjoyed that way more than I did for way longer. The first few games were engaging. And when I made that list, it was still new to us. And I was like, yeah, all over it. Sorry, what was the other one? It was Outfoxed and
Robot Turtles.
Oh, Robot Turtles. Robot Turtles is fantastic if you put the work into it. So Robot Turtles is a STEM programming game based on turtle graphics. For anyone who's old enough to remember that, like Sean and I took turtle graphics in our grade school. And it's, you know, move forward two, turn left, move forward this. And you're trying to use your turtles to collect gems on the map. It's from Think Fun. It was one of the early Kickstarter successes, but there is not enough scenarios in it. And it's very much dependent on the parents to come up with scenarios to challenge their kids. So out of the box, I don't think it's a good recommendation. But if you're into logo and program movement and you like making maps and you get part of become part of the fan community online. I think the Board Game Geek page has a bunch of people showing different scenarios. It can be still fun and engaging, but it requires a level of investment that for me made it drop off the list. Now, I didn't go delete it off the old list. I still think it's a valid recommendation.
So the chat room has brought to us Iron Forest. From Brain Games USA is the name. So it fulfilled it kickstarted in 2022.
Yes.
And I don't believe it actually has delivered yet.
Okay. That is the follow-up to Ice Cool.
Yes.
Just for those of you listening at home.
Which still as of January 24th hadn't delivered. I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, that's close, rough.
But yeah, it's
which is why I haven't heard about the game. I was excited about that one because it had a catapult that launched your people on your, I don't know what you call them, your Max. Figures. They weren't your flickers into like a top thing. It looked neat. It looked like more of a gamer's game than Ice Cool. I was looking forward to it.
Now, Roger mentions Suro and Legendary Forests were good for seniors and probably kids too.
Yeah, Suro is a fantastic game, but it's extremely light. It's a great family weight game, but to me, I was looking for like hobby gamers like this. So this would engage experienced gamer parents to play with their gamer kids. Suro can be played by anyone, which is a highlight of the game, and it plays high player counts, and it's fantastic to have at public play events. But I have no interest in ever playing Suro again myself. Like it's a neat game. What I like to do with Suro is have it at a public play event and have it set up in a corner. And that's the game you send everyone to when their table finishes up and they're waiting for other people to finish their games. And they play Suro long enough for the other table to finish. Then they go sit down and play a real game.
Roger also mentions My Farm Shop is simple and the difficulty can be scaled.
Okay. Legendary Forest. That was the other one he mentioned. Fantastic game. I played it at the CG Realm, enjoyed it. It was one of those, if I remember correctly, bingo games where everyone has the same input and you end up with different outputs. I think that's a strong recommendation. It's not one I've owned and I only played it once, but yeah, it totally belongs on the list. What was the one you just mentioned?
My Farm Shop.
My Farm Shop is not one I know. Let me just double check quick to see if it's something that once I see it, I'm like, oh yeah, okay, that sounds like a good recommendation. The artwork looks so familiar. Like, I think the same company has done other. All right, yeah, ages 8+. It's rated fairly well. That looks solid. I don't know it myself, but it looks like a good game. Very nice art iconography. It looks very clear. Anything else from the chat?
Yeah, we've got Tech mentioning his kids love Downforce. So another vote for Downforce in there. And Eggman Jr. saying Creature Comforts is his favorite KTBG game, with a simpler version for kids and an advanced version. It's great for more advanced gamers. And that's the real thing, is when you've got those dials, any of these games, that's what I think any good family weight game should have, is either the dials to adjust the difficulty or enough of a breadth of options in the game. Like, that's what Rec Raiders does, is it doesn't have dials, but because you've got your museum collection, your personal collection, and your aquariums that are all able to score for you, there's a whole lot that a grown-up can think about and try and manage, whereas the kid can just be making cool aquariums or working on their museum pieces, or maybe two of the three if they aren't ready for all three. And having that flexibility is really one of the things that makes that game such a great game for the all ages.
Oh, I agree. Yeah, Creature Comforts, we did a very short demo, like more of a, here, we're going to give you a 2-minute overview of play at Origins, and it looked really good. What I didn't know is about the advanced rules, so that's good to know. I think we only saw the simpler version. Now, that's like their take on, let's give you a worker placement game and resource management game, and I'm looking forward to that one. That is one that, honestly, we would have brought home from Origins if they hadn't sold out. So the other one I want to try, I had the name wrong earlier, is Diced Veggies. Diced Veggies looks really neat, where you have this set of dice that you like put through a tray, you put it down, and it's like not a cube of dice because it's flat, but like, you know, a grid of dice. And then you actually have a little cleaver and you have to cut the dice and then slide off, and then you use those. Yes, it did win an Origins Award. I don't remember what for, but we were at the Origins Awards and saw it. Yes, Creature Comforts won something and shortly thereafter was sold out, or maybe was sold out before the award was given. Yeah, Diced Veggies, another one I want to check out. Fossilis looked fantastic. Toyetic, but neat and thematic, where you're like moving bits of dirt and then eventually you get to the bottom and you use a little plunger and tweezers to pull out actual fossils. Well, not actual fossils. Plastic pieces shaped like fossils. That one looked really good. They kind of blew us away for again, gamers game. Like, okay, back in the day, I used to play a lot of Games Workshop games, and Games Workshop put out a series of games called the troll games, and they were meant to keep your kids occupied while you played Warhammer. And I own three out of the four that were published. I actually reviewed some of them on the blog at one point. Those were not games that would keep adults occupied, right? So it's so awesome to see that now people are publishing these games that, like, I'm trying to remember kids' table board gaming. The thing is, like, family games for serious gamers. And I realize the gatekeeping connotations to that. And I'm trying to, it's not that I don't want to think about it. Sorry, I'm failing in English. It's not that I want to think about it, but I like, what other language are you supposed to use, right? It's common parlance now to say it that way. And I love that they're doing that. Like, there are more, some gamers who are more experienced than others who are into heavier games, and they're going to play games with their kids too. So it's nice to see that there's a company catering to that.
And Creature Comforts won the Board Games Social and Light Strategy category at Origins last year, which is oddly not on on their Board Game Geek listing. I had to go to the Origins Awards to find that.
All right. Now that we've heard from the chat, how about you folk listening at home or watching on YouTube? What are some kids' games you played that you really enjoyed that you thought would be fun with your regular adult game group? Let us know by commenting, sending off an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com, or hitting me up on social media, where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
And now a word from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, who are excited to announce their first Kickstarter project of 2024, Bouba Kiki, from the mind of John Schaefer, who fans of the show should recognize as the designer of the Holiday Hijinks series of games.
Bouba Kiki uses a real-world psychological concept to facilitate gameplay. Like, let's say I asked you, what does a Bouba look like? Okay, what's a Kiki look like? Well, the world over, 90% of people would say that a Bouba is a rounded shape and a Kiki is a spiky shape, regardless of language or culture.
Bouba Kiki takes the hive mind mechanic of Just One and the storytelling scenarios of the crew and mashes them into a fun communication party game featuring six mini campaigns of ever-increasing difficulty.
I'm sold. Seriously. Like, I realize Mark's the sponsor and everything here, but like that, the entire concept has fascinated me. I wasted an entire afternoon down a Bouba Kiki rabbit hole on the internet. The when we got this announcement from Mark, here's your ad copy, right? And I'm like, oh, I got to look into this. This looks really neat.
Well, if you're like Mo, you can sign up for a launch notification over on Kickstarter. We're going to drop a link in both the chat room and the show notes as well.
And while it's not going to help you out on the Kickstarter, you can always head to GrandGamersGuild.com. And if you decide to go shopping and pick up some awesome games like Gorinto, you can save 10% by using our code Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P. Or, you know, grab one of Jonathan's other games in the Holiday Hijinks series. The newest one, the Easter one, I think is available for pre-order now.